Lord. But above what all we do, Lord, we just ask you and thank you for this day, for how you worked it out with the Fair Housing Act. As realtors and as Lord, as those who just love you today, Lord, we just say everything that we do, we give you honor and we give the glory to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now I have to pray before, you know, when you stand before audience, you tend to tell things. We at NAREA, we never lie. But I've never been known to tell the truth in different ways. So I just want to tell you that I told you I'm a beneficiary of the Fair Housing Act. But I'm more than that. You're looking at the grandson of a person that knew the value of owning the land. My grandfather and grandmother in 1924 bought a little piece of land in a little dusty town called Corsicana, Texas. They paid $2,000 for that piece of land. And my grandmother she had a vision for the future. It's not only she bought one lot, she bought the lot next to her. Because she knew if anything would happen, she could always grow groceries on that lot next to her. And something happened, and she was happy. But she struggled. She paid $6 a month to pay for a $2,000 mortgage. And they paid for it. But here I am. She didn't care about the Fair Housing Act. She didn't care anything. She knew she had to have some land under her. Because she had a son, who was my dad, and I'm the proud grandson. But here's what's important. That land still in my family today. I own those pieces of land that my grandmother and grandfather bought. And I know she's in heaven right now. Smile. But she won't let me get rid of it. I have to pay just to cut the grass. But every time I cut the grass, I think my grandmother is smiling. You're right, son. Keep on cutting that grass. That's how I made it. But the Fair Housing Act made it possible for us to live and own land in places that we could not have done before. And even though my grandmother bought that land, she didn't have any opportunity. She had to buy that land in the hood. As a matter of fact, that little piece of land is known in Corsicana as the Hill. If you're from Corsicana, they call it the Ignorant Hill. I hope that's not a reference to her grandson. But this morning we want to proceed. We got some things to cover with you. We want you to celebrate with us and understand the importance. The realtor nation struggled to get that Fair Housing Act passed. When I was young, I was living in apartments and things, didn't know anything about fair housing. But there was people, I think the pastor said it yesterday, sometimes things can be happening on this side, and God can be working out on this side. And that's what he did for the realtors nation. We can now live wherever we want to live, and it's due to that Fair Housing Act. But let's proceed this morning. I would like to bring up the president. As a matter of fact, he followed in my footsteps. I used to be the president. And I'm so glad I got able leadership to follow. But Mr. Rashad Thomas is now the president of the Dallas Association of Realtors. He's going to come and welcome you. And that's going to be followed by Ms. Beverly Davis, who's also gives a welcome. She's the director of Dallas Fair Housing Department. So will you give me a warm greeting for our president?
Capitol Hill has called Pastor Haynes, so I just welcome you. Have a good time. This is just the start of the week, so fellowship with us, have a great time, and thank you for coming. All right.
If you don't say these names in your program, as the master's ceremony gave me a little bit of power, so we're going to change it around a little bit. But remember, power goes to your head sometimes.
I'd like to say good morning and welcome to everyone. Dr. Thomas, to all the officers, to all of our esteemed guests, and especially I give honor to the greatest pastor in Dallas, Dr. Fred Haynes. As I look around the room, I see so many that have made so many contributions in the Dallas community and the greater North Texas area. And I won't start calling names because I probably will leave someone out, except I have to call attention to Mr. Babers, who has been a true pioneer, not only with the work that he has done within his role as being the HUD regional administrator, but for all the years that he worked at the ground level, helping to promote others who wish to either go into governmental employment or go into the real estate profession. So, Mr. Babers, where are you? And thank you for everything you do. As we pause to celebrate this great, momentous occasion, the 50th anniversary, I would just like to pause and reflect on one of the local heroes who played a role here in the city of Dallas. Former council member George Allen, many of you know, he was the second African-American to serve on the Dallas City Council, but he was the first who was elected to that position. In 1971, he pushed for what was called an open housing ordinance. And what the national legislation that was passed in 1968, it allowed for local communities to adopt a ordinance that would mirror the national ordinance, national law, and would give local communities the ability to enforce the laws locally. And that's how our agency came about, with that enabling local ordinance, which allowed us to establish a fair housing agency. Now, if you go back and you read the news from that time, there were all types of naysayers who were saying things like, why do we need a local law? There's already a federal law. And there were others who say, well, if you pass a law like this, it's going to make white people move out of Dallas and go to the suburbs because they won't live in a city that has a law that allows black people to live in the same neighborhoods. And so when we look at that, we have to tip our hats to him because it took courage and conviction for him to do what he did. And I think we always have to remember our history. And so I salute him today. But I would just like to say the fight is not over. Our office investigates between 80 to 100 discrimination complaints a year. And out of that 80 to 100, we probably filed 4 or 5 lawsuits a year related to housing discrimination. So I encourage you to continue the fight there on the ground level. You all are opening the doors of opportunities to our citizens in the community. We're glad to be here. We support you 100%. And if there's ever anything we can do, just please let us know. Thank you.
We are in District 7, and we have the honor this morning for this to happen, we have to have some intervention from the city of Dallas. And Kevin Felder is a councilman from this district, longtime real estate broker here. And we want to give a special thank you for him for making this possible so that we can be here this morning and address you. So, Councilman, would you please come forward? I'd like to introduce Mr. Kevin Felder, who's going to do the reads and the proclamation this morning. You use your power and authority to get us here, but there's another special person I want to acknowledge, too. It's Donaldson. Would you please stand, too? You gave her your power and authority to be here. She gave us the money, so
good morning. Good morning. Welcome to District 7. Welcome to the African American Museum. As Mr. Carter said, I am Kevin Felder, Dallas City Council, District 7. Many of you know my journey was very long to get here, but I didn't stop. The most important thing that you can do in life if you have a dream is to keep going. You can't win if you get out of the race. So I didn't get out of the race. Before I get to the proclamation, we need to talk about some issues that are very critical to us and the history. The Civil Rights Bill of 1968 was a direct result of the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. On April 5th, 1968, the day after the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., President Lyndon Johnson sent a letter to the House, Speaker of the House, John McCormick, Democrat from Massachusetts, urging immediate action in the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1968. On April 6, 1968, Senator Walter Mondale and Senator Edward Brooke, the only African American in the Senate, co-sponsored the Fair Housing Act of 1968 as an amendment to the pending Civil Rights Bill. It passed April 11, 1968. Title 8 of the Civil Rights Act of 1968, which is the Fair Housing Act, prohibits discrimination in the sale, rental, and financing of dwellings based on race, color, religion, sex, or national origin. Title 8 was amended in 1988, effective March 12, 1989, by the Fair Housing Amendments Act, which expanded the coverage of the Fair Housing Act to prohibit discrimination based on disability, on familial status, presence of children under the age of 18, and pregnant women. It established a new administrative enforcement mechanisms with HUD, with HUD attorneys bringing actions for administrative law judges on behalf of victims of housing discrimination, and revised the expanded Justice Department jurisdiction to bring suit on behalf of victims of federal district courts. Yet, in 2018, current chair Ben Carson wants to remove the word urban from the name of HUD. He also wants to remove anti-discrimination language from HUD's mission statement. Have you written him a letter? Made a phone call? Have you contacted your congresswoman to protest this egregious notion? Have you contacted Congresswoman Eddie Bernice Johnson to let her know how you feel? Have you heard from her regarding this action? Federal rent assistance programs should be used to place poor families in areas of concentrated poverty. And yet more than 100 families who receive federal rent subsidies, known as housing choice vouchers, throughout Dallas County have been placed there. Such placement perpetuates segregation. The vast majority of Dallas County's 4,200 rent subsidy users are black and are being steered to minority concentrated high poverty areas. Who can tell me who the Housing Authority administrator is? Well, the president is Albert Black. The city of Dallas is getting ready to roll out the first comprehensive housing policy ever. However, all the voices are not at the table. DAREP is not at the table. NAREP is not at the table. The Asian American Realtors are not at the table. Fannie Mae is not at the table. Freddie Mac is not at the table. The Federal Reserve is not at the table. The banks are not at the table. The Metro Texas Association of Realtors are not at the table. Yet the chair of the Housing and Economic Development Committee is Tennell Atkins. There's something wrong here. In the year of 2000, I became chair of the Fair Housing Committee at Metrotex. I discovered some ugly things. For example, Metrotex was charging a $200 fee to file a fair housing complaint. So I moved quickly to stop this practice. The Fair Housing Department function was moved to Austin. and the diversity committee was born. Also, I discovered that there were no service centers in Oak Cliff and the surrounding suburbs, and demanded that service centers be placed in the southern sector. Now there are 10. We still have work to do. My charge to you, are you doing your part? Are you raising your voice? Are you raising hell? If you're not, you're sleeping. Stay woke. I bring you greetings from the Office of the Mayor, special recognition, whereas the 50th anniversary of the Fair Housing Law is an important milestone in the history of civil rights in America. On April 11, 1968, 1 week after the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., President Lyndon Johnson signed the Fair Housing Act into law and to quell the civil unrest, protests, and riots in many cities. The signing of the landmark Civil Rights Act of 1968, which came to be known as the Fair Housing Law, not only prohibited discrimination in housing on the basis of race, color, creed, and national origin, but also helped to expand business and career opportunities for Black Americans operating in the real estate industry, and those interested in entering the real estate profession. So I can read all of the whereases, but I think you get it. Now therefore, it says Mike Rollins, but I'm gonna say Kevin Bill. It says Mayor of the City of Dallas, but I'm gonna say Dallas City Council District 7. On behalf of the City Council, on April 11, 2018, do hereby extend special recognition to the National Association of Real Estate Brokers and the Dallas Association of Realtors, celebrating the 50th anniversary of the Fair Housing Law in Dallas, Texas. Thank you.
Thank you. Kevin, I believe you got my notes there. If you don't give me those notes, I'm gonna give everybody a proclamation. Before you leave, I just want to tell you, there are a lot of people here that's not in your district. And before you got to be a councilman, before you got to be a politician, I had the pleasure and opportunity to serve on the board of directors with Mr. Kevin Fillon. Mr. Fillon has always had the interest of the African-American community in mind. He wasn't planning on running for any district, but he always spoke up on that board of directors. He always spoke in the interest of African American people. And I just want to say thank you, Kevin. We love you. We appreciate you. Ms. Donaldson is going to introduce Ms. Donaldson with Prime Linda. And she's going to introduce our speaker today. But before we introduce the speaker, let me take a minute. You gave me a new move yesterday, Pastor. And I've been practicing. Let me show it to you. Did I get it?
All right, well, good morning. How's everybody doing? Pleasure to be here. I feel like I'm amongst family. Just walking in, seeing all the familiar faces, and this is an awesome venue to commemorate such a important time in what's going on today and to celebrate 50 years. So without further ado, I want to go ahead and introduce our keynote speaker. But before I get there, we have another money person in the house too. So before I introduce Dr. Freddie, I got to introduce this Freddie. So Freddie Mac, also was co-sponsored with me. So thank you so much. So Dr. Frederick D. Haynes III, senior pastor of the Friendship West Baptist Church in Dallas, Texas for over 28 years, leads with a commitment to Christ, passion for people, and yearning for community transformation. To that end, he has grown Friendship West to nearly 12,000 during his tenure as pastor. Commitment to education. He has a bachelor's degree from Bishop College, a Master of Divinity degree from Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary, and a Doctor of Ministry from the Graduate Theological Foundation. Dr. Haynes is an author, radio show host, and foremost, a pastor. And all he does, he exudes the mantra of the late Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., believing in the urgency of now, marrying theology with a call to impact our sociological issues. Dr. Haynes serves in various leadership capacities for organizations who champion social change. He is trustee chair of the Samuel DeWitt Proctor Conference. He is on the board of directors of the National Action Network and on the board of directors of the Conference of National Black Churches, just to name a few, and demonstrates a commitment to intellectual excellence in both the church and academia, as he is a board member of Paul Quinn College, where he has also acted as adjunct professor. Dr. Haynes is married to Deborah P. Haynes, founder and president of Core Commercial, a Dallas commercial real estate firm. They are the parents of one beautiful daughter, Aubyn Jewel Haynes. Without further ado, I give you Dr. Pretty Haynes.
Thank you so much. Let me express my appreciation to each and every one of you. First of all, Ms. Donaldson, for her kind words of presentation. I also want to salute and express appreciation to the President, Mr. J. Rashad Thomas, for his leadership and for blessing me with this high honor to share with you, especially on this significant and single occasion. It means a lot to share with you because this organization, through its membership and leadership, helped hook me up when I got my first home. And so to see one of the legends in real estate here, Al Heron, is a gift to me, because Al Heron made sure when I got married that I had a house to bring my wife to. She was living in Detroit and did not want to bring her to an apartment. And so the moment I got engaged, I called up Dr. Manuel Scott of St. John. He called Al Heron, and Al Heron hooked the brother up. And so I appreciate so much the legendary Al Heron. And then to see so many familiar faces who have blessed my life through the years, it means a whole lot. Thank you so much for who you are. I also have here our executive pastor, Damian Durr, and our Minister of Justice, Danielle Ayers. They are supremely talented and gifted, and so if my presentation falls flat and short, I've already told them they can come up and speak and everything will be fine. So please know that I appreciate this honor to share with you. I'm sorry I had to kind of jack the program. I'm speaking tonight at the Progressive National Baptist Convention. We are lobbying Congress today and tomorrow in D.C. to pass some anti-poverty programs. It's one thing to salute King, but it's another thing to remember what he died fighting for. He died fighting against poverty. And so we'll be rallying Congress tomorrow. And so you pray for us, because you know it's not a friendly Congress, especially to those who fight for civil rights and fight for justice. I love your theme, and so I want to address it, even though our councilman took some of my thunder, so I'll just let what he said suffice, and I'll skip over that and jump to the rest of my presentation. Fair Housing, the Fair Housing Act, looking back, looking forward. What happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun, fester like a sore, and then run? Or does it stink like rotten meat, crust and sugar over like a syrup of sweet? Or maybe it sags like a heavy load, or does it just explode? I recite those powerful poetic words from the pen and mind of Langston Hughes, because it's a reflection of what the American dream, manifest in home ownership, has been like for those of us of Ebony Hue. I think all of us recognize when it comes to home ownership, whites have been given
through the years, a floor on which to build their American dream, whereas African Americans in too many instances have been sent to the hole. And so instead of building our dream, we have found ourselves trying to dig out of a hole. You recognize this due to the fact that public policy through the years, dating back, according to Ms. Rice, a housing expert, dating back to the 19th century, gave to white Americans the floor on which to build the American dream. You recognize that the American dream has always been seen as owning one's own home. When you own your home, you are able to position yourself to build wealth and use your home as an asset in order to finance education, not to mention any future endeavors you may have. Some have been able to finance using their homes as leverage. They've been able to finance businesses. And so white Americans have always been the beneficiaries of the American dream that gave them a floor. Of course, we remember, what is it, the mortgage or the New Deal mortgage system that came out of Franklin Delano Roosevelt's New Deal. That New Deal, in a real sense, provided, again, white Americans with a floor on which to build the American dream. But Ms. Rice, again, a housing expert, said that blacks were denied that opportunity. And so as a consequence, as whites were building their communities and building their wealth, African Americans languished in the hole of discrimination and denial. Of course, we recognize that in the 50s and 60s, Martin Luther King Jr. drum majored the parade of the Civil Rights Movement, and because Rosa Parks sat and millions marched and freedom riders rode and students sat in, we eventually were blessed with the passage of the 1964 Civil Rights Bill, which opened up the door to public accommodations, at the same time dismantling legalized Jim and Jane Crow segregation. They did not stop there, and they marched from Selma through Bloody Sunday all the way to Montgomery, causing Lyndon Baines Johnson to declare on national television, "We shall overcome." And as a consequence, the Voting Rights Bill was passed in August of 1965. But Dr. King recognized that in the aftermath, and please don't miss this, of the Voting Rights Bill being passed in August of 1965. 1 week later, Los Angeles exploded there in Watts with riots. King goes to L.A., and while in L.A., Dr. King comes to discover that what had happened with the 64 Public Accommodations Bill and 65 Voting Rights Act, in a real sense, on one level, it did not cost the nation a dime. As a matter of fact, it benefited the nation, because blacks were now able to use their resources to enrich other communities through the 64 Civil Rights Bill. The 65 Voting Rights Act did not cost America anything, but Dr. King came to realize, on the heels of the Voting Rights Bill being passed in 1965, that there was still in our nation's urban communities a denial of opportunity and abortion of possibilities. And so Langston Hughes further raises the question, what happens to a dream deferred? And then angrily answers, from river to river, uptown and down, there's liable to be confusion when your dreams get kicked around. Well, you're not feeling Langston, so maybe you can go with old school rap like Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five, because they were saying in 65, it's like a jungle. Sometimes it makes me wonder how I keep from going under. It's like a jungle. Sometimes it makes me wonder how I keep from going under. And then Grandmaster said, don't push me, because I'm close to the... I knew y'all would dance back in the day. And so with that being the case, understand that the 65 Voting Rights Act, ironically, on the heels of that, you have the explosion in Watts. King goes to Watts and discovers that there is such despair and heartbreak in the heart of the hood that something has to be done, and he now pushes for fair housing. You know what he did? He goes to Chicago and stays in the slums in Chicago, and there in Chicago, he puts the spotlight on the fact that housing discrimination causes people of color to pay more to live in dire conditions in the hood than some live in better conditions in other communities. He's putting the spotlight on racism in real estate. That's what Dr. King was doing at the end of his life as he marched to put the spotlight on housing discrimination, but also a poor people's campaign. Now, Dr. King is assassinated April 4th, 1968, on a balcony of the Lorraine Hope Motel in Memphis, Tennessee, and our nation's cities explode in resentment and rage. And Lyndon Baines Johnson knows that something must be done as a tribute to Dr. King. You know what happens? The passage of the Fair Housing Act takes place. But understand, as America has often done when it comes to passing legislation, there was a lack of enforcement. As a consequence, David Walker of Harvard University speaks of the reality of residential segregation that exists to this day. Even HUD in 2013 came to Dallas and did a study, and as our councilman Felder has already pointed out, revealed the fact that housing segregation goes on right here in Dallas, Texas. That's as recent as 2013. And so, yes, we celebrate the passage of the Fair Housing Act of 1968, but 50 years later, residential segregation continues to dismantle our dreams. 50 years later, residential segregation continues to allow, here it is, gentrification to destroy traditional communities and then displace our people into other communities. And before you know it, we look at, in a real sense, a slapping in the face of the Fair Housing Act of 1968. So 50 years later, yes, we celebrate, but 50 years later, there are lessons that we have to learn. I'm not coming through, I'll make it plain. I kind of feel like the little boy who found himself having a dream, and he was dreaming, don't miss this, of running through a field that had manicured green grass that was bordered by resplendent roses and dazzling daffodils. It's a lovely scene, but then suddenly his dream is intercepted by a bear that is chasing him. The bear chases him and chases him, is about to overtake him, and it hit me as I thought about that he, in a real sense, had a dream that was intercepted by a nightmare. And so here we see the Fair Housing Act as our dream of brand new real estate possibilities, but that dream has been interrupted by a bear of racial segregation, discrimination in real estate. It's still going on in 2018 right here in Dallas, Texas, but I'm so glad that we have the realists who are called the realtists who are stepping up and handling business for us, and because of union, we are committed to the enforcement of the 1968 Fair Housing Act. It's never enough just to have legislation passed. We've got to hold accountable those who are in position to ensure that the enforcement of the act makes the dream a reality and not a nightmare. I think I'm about to preach, so I've got to tone it down. In something that messed me up. She said, every time that we learn the game, they change the rules. Every time we move forward, they push back the finish line. And then, y'all remember Catherine in the movie. Catherine, every day, this brilliant sister found herself having to run over a mile just to use the bathroom. And so she's missing for 40 minutes. And the person played by Kevin Costner finally says, every day you go missing a couple
says, innovative. I think I came up with the answer for Pastor Haynes. I'm a deacon in a church pastor. And the deacons always offer the preachers suggestions. I got a suggestion for the preacher this morning. I know you got a Bible you put together. We need the 11th commandment. Thou shall own a house. If you don't, you're going to hell. 11th commandment. Take that with you, Pastor Haynes. Wonderful message. But he spoke in, we have a song for you right now. He spoke of We Shall Overcome. We have a young man who's a minister of music at Eastgate Fellowship International. This song has preceded us so many times and so many events. I think it's apropos that we welcome minister of music as he performs We Shall Overcome. Would you please stand with me?
Growing up in a small Black Baptist church in San Francisco, and I remember my grandmother and the other elders of the church would sit in their seats and wait for service to begin and think about the lives and the heartache and the pain that they faced. I didn't understand it at the time. Looking at what's happening today, gentrification in all of our major cities, Black boys being shot unarmed, mass incarceration, it makes us ask the question, is there any hope? And I remember my grandma, my great grandma, she would just sit in the pew and she would just begin to sing, "We shall overcome. We shall overcome." Y'all help me sing it today. We shall overcome today.
Amen.
heard a lot of language about the Fair Housing Act. There's been a gentleman on the front lines of the Fair Housing Act. As a matter of fact, he's one of the directors over at the HUD regional office. Come on, sit down for a moment and let him share his experiences and his thoughts on the Fair Housing Act. I'm bringing to the podium Mr. Thurman Miles. Been around for years and years. A lot of you met him in conversation with him. But this is from the horse's mouth.
Of course, the original act passed in 1968 was a milestone piece of legislation that covered discrimination based on race, color, religion, and national origin. Sex was not added until 1974. A lot of people missed that. But the maximum penalty for violation of the act was called a resolution to resolve. The maximum damage for a violation of 1968 was $1,000 plus attorney's fees. Even in 1968, that just wasn't a lot of money, you know? It just really wasn't. And as Dr. Haynes stated, you know, sometimes when we get something we think is a big plus, and then we get into really trying to enforce it, we find out there's some barbs along the way. And having been in Fair Housing as long as I have, I think I know all the barbs. The Amendments Act that was mentioned also by Dr. Haynes of 1988 added the two bases of familial status and disability, two groups that had previously not been protected. If you've lived as long as I have, remember the days when you'd be looking for an apartment. They say adults only, no children. Adults only, no children. I also worked with the disabled, and they used to ride around in wheelchairs, have to wear gloves because they got to roll over curbs, gravel, and all kind of stuff, no accessibility. And so the Act brought in those two new groups, the Amendments Act. In addition to that, it greatly, greatly increased the penalties for being found guilty of discrimination. I'm going to give you some current numbers that have been adjusted for inflation since 1988. But for the first offense under the Amendments Act, which now is just, you know, merged into the Fair Housing Act, it can be up to $20,111 for the first violation. And then, any violation after that, less than 5 years apart, $50,276. And that's going into the treasury. That's not even going to the complainant. For complainants, the Amendments Act said that a complainant can receive actual damages, including embarrassment and humiliation. Y'all remember Roots? And they asked Chicken George what he wanted to do with his master now that he was free. And he said, just leave him alone as long as he don't mess with me or my kind anymore, or I'll kill him. But that embarrassment and humiliation is very difficult to put any kind of a figure on. I don't know. I described it one time as feeling like you're being beat with a wet whip. And I don't even know what that feels like. But it sounds like it would be awful. In addition, the act allowed HUD to encourage and assist in developing state and local enforcement through certifying statutes and ordinances of states and local governments and substantially equivalent agencies, such as the Dallas Fair Housing Office, which our friend Beverly Davis eloquently described to you. And we're really, really happy to call them our partners because that spreads enforcement from us at HUD, and it also puts it more at a local level. Since joining HUD's Fort Worth office as an investigator in 1989, I have seen fair housing enforcement evolve. When we began implementing the Amendments Act in 1989, there were some 55% of complaints that were based on race that were filed. Disability accounted for 23%. Familial status accounted for 48%. Some of you may remember that the new act came out and there was an occupancy piece of it in terms of how many people could occupy a number of bedroom, one bedroom, a two bedroom, a three bedroom, a four bedroom. And the law was great for us at HUD in terms of enforcement. We didn't have the number to give to the industry, so it evolved. But during that time, there were many, many complaints that were filed under familial status. And we move forward to, I'll just use the year, fiscal year 2016, race only accounted for 21% of complaints filed, and disability was up to 66%. Now, what we noticed with disability was, in the beginning, it was mostly physical disabilities that we heard from in terms of complaints. Because I mentioned wheelchairs and people not having accessible routes and those kind of things. This is way prior to the ADA. You know, the ADA didn't pass in 1992. But later, it covered both physical and mental disabilities. So when the mental folk got the word, the complaints dramatically went up. And we probably have more people who claim to be mentally disabled than we do physically disabled. I went to the doctor the other day, and they said, we have a few, the nurse, I think we have a few questions for you. Have you been talking yet? Any fever or chills? No. Are you depressed? I don't think I remember being asked that in the exam room. I said, no, I'm not depressed. I'm happy all the time. But anyway, disability went up to 66%. And so you see how, I'm just trying to give you a little bit of a picture of how things have changed since 1968. And the other thing I would say is that with those penalties being as stiff as they are, it has become much, much more difficult to prove a case of discrimination. I'm so thankful that Congress put in there that investigative agencies also can resolve complaints through conciliation, mediation, because many, many times I think we get better justice that way in enforcement because we can handle it right then. But that's just something to be aware of. The Fair Housing Act is very comprehensive in its coverage of discrimination in housing. It also included residential real estate related transactions of lending, appraising, hazardous title insurance companies, and homeowners associations. So it made it unlawful for any person or entity whose business includes engaging in real estate related transactions to discriminate against any person in making available those transactions or in the terms and conditions of such a transaction because of race, color, sex, religion, community status, disability, and national origin. So that's very important because it's one thing to be able to rent wherever you want to, but it's another to be able to buy wherever you want to. That's where you guys come into it. We serve a very important function. I feel that Dr. Haynes mentioned the predatory lending. I think we had more education of our consumers about what is a good loan. And I'm a realtor myself, so I know how to do that. We wouldn't have that predatory lending because they wouldn't know. Anytime it sounds like it's too good to be true, it is. So why do we keep on falling for it and blaming somebody else? We have to know what we're doing. So what progress have we made? I want to take a little bit of a stab at this. The current commission that was appointed by LBJ after the 1960s riot recommended a few policy changes. One of them was making affordable housing available across metro regions. And I think the reason they said metro regions is because the opportunities for us were not across metro regions. I had a sign that I used in one presentation in Detroit, where they had a big sign in Detroit saying, housing for whites in my neighborhood. They didn't want any blacks, they carried signs. Improving the quality of housing stock was another goal. Then making home ownership more attainable and creating policies that break down segregated neighborhoods and allow African Americans the freedom to live where they choose and closer to higher paying jobs. That's what was listed by the Turner Commission report. I think some progress has been made in that the quality of housing stock has improved over the years in many areas. New financing tools such as tax credit-based financing on the private side, Hope 6 financing on the public side. Currently there's a program called RAD that I think is going to also continue that trend. Home ownership also increased over the years with the emphasis of the Clinton and Bush 2 administration's emphasis on home ownership. Unfortunately, in many instances, the creative financing utilized to achieve this contributed to the foreclosure crisis that we experienced in 2008-2009. That's what Justin Haynes was speaking of earlier. It seems that President Clinton did a good job of increasing home ownership. I was in the administration, and I was also in the Bush administration. I remember when he said, well, we're gonna increase homeownership among minorities but five and a half million new homeowners. And it's all about doing that. Because once again, through some of that finance, you know, people ended up losing those homes because of the bad finances that it was. So we've been tasked with requiring recipients of fair housing funds since the inception of the Fair Housing Act to affirmatively further fair housing by seeking to decrease segregation. This is something that during the Obama administration, there was a passage of the ALFH rule that required these states and municipalities to whoever who receives CDBG funds and other federal funds to develop plans and strategies to analyze the state of fair housing in their communities and to seek to spur development of affordable housing in areas of opportunity. Sadly, I think, HUD has decided to defer implementation of this rule until 2020 as the technical aspects of the analysis is required. That's what we're doing now. But during all of this, the Fair Housing Act continues to be a tool for individual citizens to pursue complaints of discrimination as they seek to rent and buy homes in any area of the city that they qualify to rent a home. I think that Dallas has made a lot of strides in improving housing stock growth in racially concentrated areas and to some extent in moving out to the suburbs. But I think we have to pay close attention to the trends and the mood of the country. As we have seen in the past, the country has a way, it seems, to shift from one basis to another in practicing discrimination. There are still areas that discrimination is occurring that are not included in the Fair Housing Act as protected classes. One of those areas is people who have criminal records and arrest records, can't rent, certainly can't own. LGBT is one, another one, and there are others. Just as we saw race shift from the top in complaints filed, we now see a higher number of complaints based on sex and sexual harassment. As policies change, there could be more national origin complaints, think about immigration, going forward, and it would not surprise me to see race complaints come back as well as retaliation and intimidation. So I see going forward that we will always have a busy staff at Fair Housing. and it's really my hope that we all will continue to have strong enforcement of the Fair Housing Act for all protected classes, and that we remain vigilant in the community to promote fair housing in all aspects of the housing market. Yeah. Again, we at HUD appreciate the opportunity to be here. We appreciate the realtors in continuing your mission in the housing industry. Thank you very much.
I tell you, realtors are innovative people. And I think I got another, and like Al was talking about the revenue streams. He said you get $50,000, the penalty for $50,000. And I did a little bit of calculation. $50,000, that's 6%, that's $3,000. We may have to start looking for some discrimination today. 10 of those is $60,000. Can we contact you for our commission check? We're in the revenue stream. But we talked about moving forward. We also have a gentleman here. We all know Mr. Don Baker, would you come up, please? He's going to just talk a little bit about looking back. He was in that struggle many, many years ago. But I also warn you, too, that Pastor Haynes brought some thunder into the house today. So stay tuned. We're going to have some lightning in a few minutes.
Good morning. It is certainly a pleasure and an honor to be with you today. When I look out, it's like homecoming. Beverly Davis, it's certainly good to see you and your staff who served as my former co-worker, Thurman Miles. And I look around and I see Mr. Harrison and all. This is an exciting day. exciting time. And as we talk about fair housing, we talk about moving, looking back, looking forward. Very interesting. I came into HUD in 1970, not realizing all the things that had taken place. I was in college in 68. And I was a product of affirmative action, actually, not even realizing that I was looking for a job, primarily teaching and coaching, and ended up in the federal government. Little did I know, when I went to HUD, I had the privilege of meeting on the first day a gentleman by the name of A. Macy O. Smith. Wow. Not only did I get a chance to meet Mr. Smith, but also a gentleman by the name of Sam Hudson, who many of you here in Dallas know. Then there was another gentleman by the name of Harold Odom, who was the older brother of the mayor of Arlington, Ozzie Odom. These three gentlemen ran the Office of Fair Housing and Equal Opportunity. I came in as an equal opportunity specialist, not knowing what it was, but the mission was to take care of people having discrimination problems. I'm curious, how many of you in the audience today actually filed a discrimination complaint? I'm sure most of you have actually been discriminated against and probably did not know it or did not recognize it. So, again, we have heard about the Civil Rights Act of 68, and again, coming into play in 70, that is when HUD came into play. Up to that point, it had been FHA, Federal Housing Administration. And believe me, it was tough. Underwriting standards are tough. But again, we had this new Fair Housing Act. Well, Thurman didn't mention, and I did not realize, even though it was passed in 68, and we basically said, everybody can now go out and find a home, the handbooks had not been done. So you had no real guidance. My first assignment from Fort Worth was to go to Little Rock and run the state office for fair housing in the state of Arkansas. Well, here again, my intent as a young 23, 24-year-old was I'm going to work myself out of a job real quick. Well, we hear Barrett was still getting 100 complaints, and this is probably 48 years later. So needless to say, we've got a lot of work to do. We've had a lot of laws passed. But a lot of it, I hate to say, now that I stand on the other side, is somewhat empty. There was a gentleman that I met from the Chicago HUD office at one point. And he was a very interesting gentleman, and what he did, he locked up in his office and protested and called the press, and he said, if this is HUD's commitment to fair housing, it sucks. And what he was basically saying is the state of Illinois had one individual in the office. So how the hell can you do discrimination with one individual in an entire state? So we applaud on one hand the effort of giving us the law, but on the other side of the coin, if the mandate is not funded properly, you are not staffed properly, it's a problem. So needless to say, we go forward, we try to do the work. And the games were being played, I mean big time games. I would go to housing authorities. Many of the sisters there would be approached by the maintenance man knocking on the door, opening the door all at the same time. But where did you go? When you were evicted in Bard City, Arkansas, where did you go? There was no other place to go. So needless to say, I saw a lot of problems, a lot of just real things that was very sickening. But I want to fast forward to probably 1987, when I came to Dallas. This is when the light began to come on. This very organization, and for you new members in DARC, let me just say, I was embraced by this organization, by the lights, and Mrs. Mabel White, Arnold Blair, Al Heron, Mr. Galloway, Fred Blair, and many others in this community. And this again was 1987. I had done time in Arkansas and had come back. But it was as bad at 89 as it was in 70. Mabel White and her husband gave me a tour of the southern part of Dallas. And one of the things that I was told was that FHA was not making any loans in the southern sector. Very astounding to me, but I was going to the realtor lender committee as well, where most of the white lenders and realtors were. And that was not a problem, other than for a young lady named Jan White, who worked, I guess her father was Judge White. A large percentage of their business was in Oak Cliff in the southern sector, and she pulled me to the side and said, "You guys are not making loans in the southern sector." And I, "What do you mean?" She said, "Well, we are having problems." This, and many of you have heard, was about the Bodark Foundation. So we went out, found out that Bodark was actually cross ties that had been soaked in creosote. So certainly my study says that termites did not like Bodark, so that wasn't a problem. So here again, law passed in 68. This is probably 89. So we have to make a change. There was a manual, many of you have heard of it. It was called the Underwriting Manual. Some interesting things were in this manual, but by the time I came along, most of it had been scrubbed. But there was a score called A, B, C, and D. A described the best properties. B was still desirable, and C was declining. D was hazardous. So where do you think South Dallas was? D, absolutely. So needless to say, these things had to change, and we did change it. But it was this organization that had a lot to do. I mean, other things had taken place, but certainly, the thing that Reverend Haynes mentioned this morning, in the sense of coming together, working together, and banding together, has a lot of merit. I have in my notes, the more things change, the more they stay the same. Mm-hmm. So again, as we stand here, 2018, we still have a lot of work. In a sensible world, the federal government would be suppressing predatory lending while beefing up programs that provide affordable home mortgages and refinancing arrangements. Instead, this administration and Congress are gearing up to gut federal fair housing lending protection and make it easier to hide emerging patterns of predatory finance. Okay, so with that being said, in the absence of federal leadership, in the absence of real leadership that HUD, and I say it because I don't work there anymore. What career could be left with mayors and governors having another problem that we had in 2010 and 2011? You're right, we increased home ownership by 5 million at some point. But all of that has been lost because of the problems that we're still having in 2018. It is real when we talk about financial and economic gains as it relates to housing. We don't have the means because the equity is not there. The equity is not there because we were denied on the front end. So again, as Reverend has stated, it is incumbent upon us to come together, and I love what he said about working with the faith community. This was one of my things that I tried to do when I was active. I was at NARAP, the whole bit. But it was primarily to spread the word, to carry the message, and to make it known what was happening downtown. I didn't share it completely, but John Wiley, the mission of John Wiley was the man downtown. A few would say that's our housing guy downtown. So again, it was to primarily to educate, because you know, to have it and not be able to tap into it doesn't do us any good. So we can have all the laws on the book, but if we don't have the knowledge, the education, and to let our friends, family, and individuals know, then it's still back in 1968. So we, and particularly as this organization, I challenge you today that you come together. Certainly I work closely with the city of Dallas, certainly HUD, and I think it's incumbent that you get and follow up on that. And if any way I can be of any service, I'll be more than happy to come back and work with you to make that happen. Because again, this is 2018. We've got 2 or 3 more years to go with our current administration. And it is not looking good, bottom line. So I challenge this organization to step up to the plate, do what you need to do, and make it happen. Stay warm.
Wow. Thank you, Mr. Bates. And we've had a whole lot of fun. We've had a little bit of rain. But now I told you that get ready for the lightning. The lightning strike together. Jump back. I know you can file lawsuits and do all that kind of thing. But I got one other cure for getting fair housing. There's a young lady here, she a fuss and cuss. Fussing and cussing moves it forward. When I first saw her, they were dragging her out of the city council chamber. I think they put a handcuff on her, whatever it is. Young lady at the time, but she knew about housing. She never left her community. She was born fair housing. So if you will, for this young lady, why don't you stand on your feet and help me welcome former council member Diane Ramsey. She saw a question about the Christmas giving it out.
I don't want to knock it over.
My pleasure. My pleasure to be here and to share some comments with you. You know, affordable housing is a major issue in this city. And we continue to have homelessness for a reason, because we have the absence of affordable housing. You know, one of the key purposes of the Federal Housing Act is to give people the right to live where they choose to live. So if an African American chooses to live in a white middle class community, they should have that right. Now, what we have found out time and time again, this is why I'm moving towards self-determination more and more. What we have found out time and time again, that when we move to the suburbs, it becomes majority what? From white to black. We need to be real, white flight is a reality. Oak Cliff at one point in time used to be what? Overwhelmingly Anglo. You know, we need to be honest with ourselves. White flight is a reality. While we move to try to integrate and desegregate neighborhoods, Anglo say, I prefer to keep on moving. Okay, but Lothian, Mansfield, etc. We need to be honest with ourselves. When we moved to Duncanville, they moved out, many of whom. Duncanville now is majority what? African American, majority minority. When we moved to Cedar Hill, etc., we need to acknowledge the fact that white flight is a reality. And so therefore, it's going to be more and more difficult to desegregate, okay? That's just the reality. Even with the law, it's going to be more and more difficult to desegregate because of white flight. This is not something that Diane desires. This is a reality. Racism is a reality, and we need to acknowledge that. And so, and time again, we want to ignore that, but we cannot. Then once we look at the neighborhoods in Southern Dallas in particular, we notice that in many ways the city of Dallas itself created a different through zoning, etc., to ensure that there were conditions in various neighborhoods which would be unacceptable to people. However, though, that's where we were allowed to live. And so in Southern Dallas, many times you had zoning that created unacceptable conditions. I'm looking at my council member over here, Councilmember Feldman, who had to fight to eliminate environmental issues within Joplin. Right, batching plants, concrete plants, environmental racism. All of these things affect housing. Zoning, how land is used, how land is zoned affects housing. And so we cannot ignore that. If indeed the city fathers, the city mothers made a decision that they wanted Bishop Arch to be a wonderful area, that was done with the city of Dallas, with the zoning, in a good way. And so you can use zoning in a bad way. So it's important. So we cannot talk about housing without talking about other conditions, in particular zoning and land use. Am I making any sense? And so not only must we recognize that racism is a reality as evidenced by white flight, we got to recognize that zoning and land use and other issues indeed create conditions within our community that make them unacceptable in which to live. That if the African American chooses, like myself, born and raised in the hood, still living in the hood, if an African American chooses to live in a concentrated minority and working poor neighborhood, I also should have that right. And so as we look at the proposed housing policy that the city of Dallas is considering right now, it denies an individual the right to live where they desire to live, because there are neighborhoods that the city of Dallas proposed in their proposed housing policy. There are neighborhoods that will be redlined. In essence, I am saying that the proposed housing policy will exclude many neighborhoods from financial investments. And so that is what, and they maintain they have to do that based upon the limited resources. And I say that the resources don't have to be limited, that you have the influence and the authority to go out there and leverage the the $1 billion budget that you have to indeed generate additional money. Am I making any sense? And so you can use your money to leverage additional dollars if you have the will. And so it is absolutely amazing to me that the city of Dallas would even consider ignoring so many neighborhoods in their housing policy, because it is the city of Dallas in significant part that is responsible for the poverty and the inhumane conditions within minority and working poor neighborhoods. They themselves are liable for bad zoning. The City Planning Commission, on which I serve, the City Council, on which I serve, you can do good zoning or you can do bad zoning to promote a good quality of life. And so we cannot ignore that, am I right? And now they have the gall, I'm talking about the City of Dallas with respect to their proposed housing policy. They have the gall. The City of Dallas wants to further penalize us for the racist policies that they themselves created and allowed. And that shall not take place. We must insist upon public policies that are fair and just, and policies that include us all. When you do your activism, it should be policies that include us all. When you confront the public officials, when you move forward to create public policy, it should what? Include us all. Our policies that we fight for cannot be elitist or classist. That we must do those things that include us all. Now, I saw Mayor Rollins yesterday morning on TV, perhaps you did as well. And he wants to focus on the elimination of poverty during the balance of his term. And what the mayor needs to understand, and what we need to help him understand, is that affordable home ownership can lead to the elimination of poverty. Because home ownership stabilizes families. It is well documented that homeownership increases the academic performance of our children and helps to create healthy and safe neighborhoods. The number one way that most Americans create wealth is through homeownership. Now, and yet homeownership rates, at this present time, we need to understand it. This is not Diane's research. And yet homeownership rates have remained unchanged for African Americans over the last 50 years. You got to be right. This is based upon the Institute for Economic Policy. Over the last 50 years, homeownership rates for African Americans have basically unchanged. Black homeownership is about 40%, which is 30% behind the rate for whites, and is due in significant part to public and private redlining. We must challenge the banks. We must challenge the banks. We must use the CRA to ensure that banks are held accountable. We must ask our elected officials to work with us to challenge banks, because banks continue to redline our communities. And so we not only have private redlining, but we also have public redlining in this city as well. The research shows that the wealth position, this is something else, that the wealth position of an African-American head of household who is a college graduate is less than the wealth position of an African-American head of household who is a high school dropout. What am I saying, Diane? What am I saying? I'm saying that race does matter. Race continues to matter. That's why we have the white flight. That's why we have racism with respect to redlining. Race does matter, and racism continues to be alive and well. Let me repeat that. That the wealth position, the net worth of an African-American head of household who is a college graduate, is less than the wealth position of an Anglo head of household who is a high school dropout. Race lives. Race matters. Racism is alive and well. And so therefore, what must happen? What must we do? What must we look at? Yes, we can continue to lift up integration and desegregation. I'm not ruling that out. We fought for it. You need to live wherever you want to live if you can qualify for the house. Am I right? So I'm not ruling that out. But we got to emphasize more and more on self-determination. Right. We got to create programs and institutions and businesses ourselves that will address the problems within our community. Right. Because racism will be available today. When we die, racism will still be here. We cannot look in the next 50 years and said, do you know what? Basically, our condition as a people, I'm talking as African Americans, is unchanged. We don't want to give that up. We don't want to look, of course, now I don't think anybody here is going to be alive. Well, that young man might be alive. but my point, though, we want a better future for those young people. And so we need to look at another type of strategy. Yeah, I'm not saying that we don't want integration, but I am saying that the last 50 years, in my opinion, based upon the data, based upon the research, the last 50 years indicated to us that basically our conditions are our condition as a people is unchanged. And so therefore we need to look at something else. We need to look at the creation of our businesses, ourselves, to hire our people. Am I right? We need to look at building homes ourselves. We need to look at pulling our resources to finance our homes. Am I right? And so we need to make sure that what we do is done in such a way to enhance the principle and philosophy of self-determination. Let me talk about in particular just briefly in Dallas County. Let me lift up a few stats. The Asian income, the Asian American annual income and Anglo annual income is $68,000. The Hispanic annual income is $40,000. And the African American annual income is $37,000. And so, and while I believe, as I've indicated, that we should be able to live wherever we desire to live, research proves, I regret to say time and time again, that after the passage of the Pearl Housing Act, our progress is really insignificant as a people. Now, don't get me wrong, a few of us have made it. A few of us have made it. But as a people, I'm concerned about all of us. And as a people, indeed, we have not made significant change. And therefore, in my opinion, we need to de-emphasize, with all due respect, de-emphasize integration and emphasize self-determination in order to move our progress. As I indicated, we gotta make sure that we create the necessary institutions and businesses that would help us improve our quality of life. And also that will make sure that no one is left behind. Thank you so very kindly.
We have one right here in the Dallas, Texas area.
Mr. Vincent Wimby. For that Fair Housing Act. He took it all the way to Washington, D.C. I just wish he'd been president when Donald Trump was elected president. But you think Diane Ragsdale can cuss and get results? Mr. Wimbish, as a president, speak national cussing.
Commercial, industrial, or special purpose. As a child, I did not know anything about segregation, nor the harsh realities of the Jim Crow South. I didn't know at the time why my grandmother packed us a lunch, or why we stopped roadside to relieve ourselves from traveling out of town to visit my great-grandparents. I'm proud to say that my grandparents and my great-grandparents were both property owners, and my wife's grandparents, great-grandparents were property owners. They bought land, 100 acres, in 1898, and that 100 acres is still in the family today. I'm equally proud to say that I vividly remember in 1960 when my parents bought their first home. As you've heard from several people who have spoken today, we didn't need their house. Some of us didn't need their house to own the property. So it's why it's not for all of us. We need to help those that it is instituted for. We moved from a public housing project to our own home. In the 1950s, public housing, at least in Texas, was an upgrade. And I say that because it had indoor plumbing, older rural housing had outhouses. Public housing was established after World War II and was developed to provide decent and safe transitional rental housing for eligible low-income families, the elderly, and persons with disabilities as our society transitioned from rural to urban. It was supposed to be one of the stepping stones to home ownership and intended to be temporary housing, never permanent housing. History tells us that decent, safe, affordable, and sustainable housing has been an issue in America for a long time. While government, private investors, and nonprofits have partnered from time to time to fund housing initiatives, nothing has fully addressed the challenges of providing a sufficient supply of affordable, sustainable housing, which creates desirable neighborhoods and communities. I want to take a moment to talk about a neighborhood's life cycle so that we can understand how a neighborhood transitions. A neighborhood has four life cycles, and it encompasses approximately 60 years, which covers about 2 30-year mortgage periods. Each stage lasts approximately 15 years. The first stage in a neighborhood's life cycle is growth, and that is identified by new construction. It is typically developed in rural and suburban areas where they have large acres tracts of land that are ideal for residential development. Due to their low cost, low value, and proximity to economic and employment sectors, the second stage is maturity, which is renovation. This stage is noted when most of the homes in the community are still on the occupied and are being renovated and updated to provide more functionality. Lifestyles change, many homes are expanded and are modified to create additional living areas. Towards the end of this period, the first market cycle is coming to an end. The third stage is declining. This period is defined by tenant occupancy. The original owner is typically transitioning to a larger or smaller property, and depending upon its maintenance, it may be attracted to a first-time home buyer or investor. Keep in mind, investors typically only do cosmetic, repairs, renovations that may or may not increase the value of the property as it transitions to a rental home. And the fourth stage is the focus that most of us find ourselves in, especially if you're on the inner city or any urban area. And that's decay. It's also known as revitalization or gentrification. Revitalization means to make new or to restore life new. This stage is defined when properties have not been well maintained and are not livable or habitable and need extensive remodeling and or renovations. Now, I'm going to, the rest of my talk is going to be focused on solutions. And the federal government through HUD, the Department of Housing and Urban Development, return millions of dollars every year to the state, to the county, and to the municipalities based upon the census data. Okay? In 2020, we're coming up on a year that the census is going to be taken. So, those dollars are allocated to the communities based upon the census data and federal income taxes that they collect from those jurisdictions. Politicians at all levels make these decisions on how these funds are to be allocated and which projects are to be funded. Let me say also that communities are our responsibility. And there are numerous opportunities despite the current state of life. That's why other agencies keep acquiring properties in our community. Have we experienced that?
Every day.
I hate to say this, but we are the only people that don't see value in our community. Key to controlling gentrification is home ownership, property maintenance, and a vision for that community that it can be what we envision it to be. We determine that. And one of the other keys is how we educate our children. We need to elect people who represent the community and support development and create opportunities such as jobs, housing, and education for that community. We have single member districts, and we do not hold our politicians accountable by demanding our fair share of the public funds for community development. Politicians should adopt policies that assist current fixed income homeowners with renovations and maintenance that adds functionality and value with the use of those HUD funds that they receive. Churches should create housing nonprofits and are partnered with existing nonprofits and other churches to purchase the deteriorated housing stock, including apartments, numerous vacant home sites, and commercial establishments to control the economic dynamics in our community. HUD has numerous multifamily complexes that they are willing to donate, sell, and assist with financing. This can be accomplished through the existing talent within church congregations. Renovations and maintenance of existing housing stock will create jobs. Buildings with apartment complexes can be converted to resource centers, educational facilities, recreational centers, food banks to assist tenants with developing skills to be self-sufficient and feed families. We need to stop asking other people to do for us what we are fully capable of doing for ourselves. Discipline, and vocational classes that offer training and career opportunities like nursing, carpentry, plumbing, electrical, auto mechanics, sharking and dictation, secretary, and bookkeeping and schemes. Most important, I believe students learn skills that was marketable if they did not want to continue their education in college. Vocational training allows and continues to offer five career options to attain license in trades that help them determine their own destiny and build an income base. We as a community and as a nation need the educational system to remove the necessary training classes that prepare our children with skills they need to compete for viable job opportunities. In my opinion, the current system only teaches our children how to take a test, but not critical thinking, problem-solving skills that are necessary to be an entrepreneur or to create or to be a job creator in our community. Since the year 2000, there has been over $2 billion of development in the southern sector of Dallas. The majority of that being in churches, big box shopping centers, and our fast food restaurants. Many of the faith-based institutions and their facilities are only used twice a week. They sit vacant for 5 days. These buildings are valuable assets in our communities where they are located and are not being utilized to their full potential. We have numerous retired teachers and administrators in our community who provide tutoring, mentoring, counseling, and our instructional guidance in these empty buildings if education and training programs exist. Depending upon a public education system that do not care, love, nor have patience to educate our children to be productive citizens is the definition of insanity. We keep doing the same thing, expecting it different. Our children need to be tutored, mentored, counseled, and educated by people who would love and nurture them to achieve beyond their wildest dreams. Churches should open charter schools and educate and train our children to take control of their own destiny. We need to control the education our children receive as well as having role models that look like them who are successful. Power is conceded to no one. It is taken. Thank you.
Sitting in the chair, but you're still president. He speaks soft, but he carries a big stick. He's still taking it to the neighborhood. All right, we have a dean among the southern sector. A dean among all deans. He's the chief of deans. I don't think there's a stranger person here that does not know Mr. Al Harris. All right. Sometimes they get us mixed up. Sometimes they say we look alike. But I want you to know, he does follow the paleo diet. I don't follow the paleo diet. But come on up, Mr. Harris. We have one other distinguishing character, Mr. I think I got a little bit more hair than you got. But he has experience. He's been here in this sector. He's lived it. He's promoted it. He knows everything about it. So it's my honor and my pleasure to let you hear Mr. Al Harrell.
Thank you, Mr. Carter. Thank you for inviting me to come today. And this has been quite a day, and it's been well spent. I won't keep you long. Now, as they ask me, well, understand because I think they think I'm the oldest one of them. So I can tell from them. But listen, when we look and see what's happening today, it may give you some headaches like it has been giving me. I've been real concerned about where we stand. Because when all of these years we've been making progress, we've been, we can depend on even the government to help us. But we ended up having an election. We had an election, and so I've been sort of depressed. I don't like to get that kind of thing. So I keep talking about all of these things going on, but housing, here's what I know. I know that housing is the key. And listen, for those of you who don't know, I grew up in Jefferson Davis County, Mississippi. And we had the final ever turn to achieve or accomplish anything. And I didn't expect to come this time here in Dallas, Texas, in where we witnessed after having a black president in office, we say, we did overcome. But I tell you, we don't need to get too bent out of shape. We had go, I do like I did. I had to go get the Dr. Martin Luther King speech because I have a dream speech I had to go get. And I read in there, he said that there'll be some difficult days ahead. But he said, we'll get there. He said, I may not get there with you, but we'll get to the promised land. And after I had to read that, because they put a man in charge of HUD. Were it not for HUD, only these 40% of us that own home, that would not be the case if we didn't have HUD. And we put this man in charge of HUD that when I grew up and we had to fight in Mississippi, we had a name for people like him. Because they would get somebody like us to join them in trying to hold us back. And so they put Ben Carson in charge of HUD. And I know the name for him. The same one we had when we were growing up. Uncle Tom! But Dr. King, the reason I can stand it, the reason I can get this ready, because I am confident he was a prophet. And Dr. King said that we'll get there. We will get to freedom. We will get, he may not get there with us. So I'm convinced that even though this administration is trying to deny us what is rightfully ours, but they won't be able to succeed in doing it. They killed the dream in Memphis, the dreamer. They killed the dreamer in Memphis. But they can't kill the dream. It will live on forever and ever and ever.
Oh, man.
Thank you, Mr. Aaron. Mr. Davis, can you stand? Ms. Davis? Sister Ramsey? Stand 1 minute. I think you've heard some, is the council still here? You've heard some great ideas today. Mr. Miles, could you stand? You've heard some great ideas. We heard some thunder and some lightning, and I understand. here to stand. Reverend Haynes, we have some thunder, some lightning, some wind, some everything. Brother Al Heron stood up before we clapped today for some thank you. Brother Al Heron threw some hailstorm. And I was going to press some Douglas hailstorm. Is this being recorded anywhere? Can y'all please censor that hailstorm? What you call it, the Secretary of Doug? Uncle who? Now, we may have to go to the hood and ask for some money. So, I'm pragmatic, so if y'all be trying to cancel out that Uncle Tom. Anyway, Rochelle, I think you may have to ask for some support money. But thank you so much. Would you all please give these speakers a hand? President is going to give his final remarks.
Thank you. I kind of rushed through so we could make sure that we got Pastor Haynes on his way to Capitol Hill, but I'd be remiss if I didn't acknowledge some people that mean a lot to me. Our National Women's Council President, don't look back, it's you. And also our past president of the Dallas Association of Realtors. Mr. Vincent Wimbush, even before I was even receiving the purpose call. You know, you always get the call, you always get the message, but you don't always receive it. We were at Nashville, I don't know how many years ago. He said, "You're gonna be on the National Nominating Committee." I said, "Who?" He said, "Me." So that's, I've been the National Chair of the Nominating Committee, and it was all due to past President Marvin. So. Mr. Everything, the person that's actually reinvested in the community. We talked a lot of things, we talked about a lot of things today, but when everyone else runs to another community, Mr. Al Heron is reinvesting in his community. So come up, Al. And he was also my mom's first broker too, so. So I owe this legacy, this lineage also to Galloway Heron and Associates, because he always told my mom, make sure you invest in real estate, so thank you for that also. And I hope you all received the word from this young man. He spoke and sang from the heart, so, and his first name is Rashad, so I know he's got to be a great guy. Rashad, come on. Also, get some cake. It's from Cake Dad. Is anybody going to make it? Okay, so don't waste it. Don't waste it in here. So, but get some cake. And also, one of the two of the most important people that made this possible.
Ben Grant.
Well, I'm not going to say two, but
Ben
three. Our title sponsor, please come up. We already have something for you, but I just want to recognize you. Also, did she leave? Okay, yeah, please come up, come up. These two ladies are instrumental in making this whole thing possible, so I don't know if you're on the docket for some more remarks, but if you want some, hopefully I have the privilege and privilege, so.
First of all, I just want to thank Dereb and Rashad. You're doing a phenomenal job. Any young realtors coming up, this is who you need to come and talk to, because we need this in our community. You know, when Pastor Haynes talked about us rebuilding, we need more young people to come forth and take leadership. So on behalf of Carter Lending, I just want to thank each of you for attending today. We are a partner with you in this community. We have rolled out so many additional products in the last year to really go out and reach our first-time home buyers. One of the biggest products that we added this past year was our VA renovation loan. So if you want to know more about that, come talk to me about it. So at this time, I'm going to turn the mic over to my partner in crime, Tamla.
Hi, I'm Tamla Hartswell. I'm afraid that. Just want to say that we are very happy to support this effort, and we will be supporting DARA the entire year and beyond, because we are committed to fair housing and affordable rent. So thank you very much for having us.
And also, my mind is, I'm not that old, but my mind is really Romeo, always, the whole MetroTech staff, very integral and necessary. Thank you all. thank you for everything. Also, one more person. If you love this venue, this is the African American Museum. One of my initiatives and things that I really want to do is make sure that we support our venues and our businesses. So, African American Museum, please come up. Thank you for hosting us.
Tickets are $10. You can get them here or at the box office day of. But the thing about it is, like we've heard all the whole time today, it's important that our youth in this community see professionals that look like them and leaders that look like them come back to their community and enjoy and be happy and smiling. And these are the opportunities for us to do that. So thank y'all so much for coming out and thinking about the museum.
I just want to thank you again, and that's my time. So I know y'all ready to go, so we're going to keep the program moving.
Okay. Thank you all so much. It does my heart to see everybody that showed up. I know I'm begging and pleading with all these people to come. I called all of them personally, and they so graciously consented. But I personally know just about everybody. But wasn't this a wonderful program? I think we did Fahrenheit justice. Do you think so? Yeah. And I also want to thank Ms. Beverly Davis for consenting to forego her program to come and share with us, you know. So they're here with us to help us celebrate this occasion. So I want to thank her. I also want to thank the Art Institute who's been filming this event. They're back here taking awesome saw the paper and they said we really want to film this event, so they have been, I don't know if y'all saw them back there, they've been real quiet, and they didn't walk over anybody or you know, make a big ruckus or whatever, but we want to thank them. Also, I want to tell you all about the rest. Y'all know that this is Realtors Week. We always have, we have activities every day. So the next couple of days, especially, if you have not registered for the Lunch and Learn, it is tomorrow at the Hilton Garden Inn out on 20 and Main in Duncanville. It is a free event. It's at 11:30 a.m. The name of it is How to Tackle Down Payment Assistance. How to Tackle It, okay? So we're having down payment assistance programs from all over, from Dallas, from the county, from I believe Fort Worth, from go online and get and sign up. Please, we have sheets over on the registration table. You can sign up, okay? So if you'd like to come to that event, you get a free lunch and find out about all the down payment assistance programs. We also have USDA, we have just anything that you want. Most of those people are gonna be there and they're gonna tell you about their programs, any changes or whatever. Because we need that in our communities. We need people to, we need money, okay? A lot of people, some of them have the credit, not the money, some have the money and not the credit, so whatever, but we have that. Okay, then the next day, y'all know they talked about the housing policy. We have the people direct. We have politicians that's gonna be there on Wednesday.
Wednesday's event is in, along with Metrotex, we're having the Political Advocacy Day. And it's going to be at Metrotex. We need people to show up, okay? If you want, we do have individuals from, we have the Director of Housing that's going to be there, and we have Ms. Karen Riley, who is over that housing policy program. Well, that particular program that everybody's been talking about. Okay, if you want to ask them some questions, please come. I mean, some people don't even know what it is, okay? So please come out. It's going to be at 10 o'clock on Wednesday at 10 o'clock. We do have forms over there. You can register. I know it was on. It's on, also online on the Metrotex calendar. So if you'd like to go register that way, that's fine. But you can register today before you leave, all right, by signing up, okay? We also have some other events, but one of that we're sharing. But do you want to talk about the Friday?
The Thursday event, we will be partnering with TreePack to support them. So it's going to be over 500 professionals there. So if you are a professional and you're part of Metrotex, then that's where you want to be. And it's a white party. So, you know, you don't really need an excuse to wear white. So, well, I know I don't, but. and it's for a good cause. We're raising money for TreePack. You never know when you're going to need TreePack. So Friday, we're volunteering our time at IDEA Innovation Design Entrepreneurial Academy, 4800 Ross. If you're looking for business in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, you have to reciprocate. So you have to do something good in your community if you plan on receiving business from your community. So, and it's an entrepreneurial school, so we're all business people, and it's your duty to grow the next leaders. So Saturday, we're going to have a huge home buyer seminar. If you listen to 94.5 or 105.7, the people that they're talking about April 21st, that's us. So please come out. If you have buyers, send them out. We're not going to take your clients or anything. We're just trying to educate them. Our initiative this year was to educate 10,000 potential home buyers. And we're well on our way, but we need you all to tell people about it. So it's at Friendship West from 10 to 3. Everything's free, and there's a giveaway, so you might go home with a big screen TV. So if you're lucky. But we know one person that she wins everything. And I also forgot our Fort Worth chapter president, Angela Gilchrist. If she, she might have left already. Oh no, there she is. Okay, I'm sorry. You know, charge it to my mind and not my heart. You know I love you. So, Terry Attaway, sorry, I apologize. National board member, thank you for always supporting us. Our friends to the West. So, I think that's it.
Hey, Ben.
Okay, but if you have any questions, most people have my number, please give me a call. But we do have a few slots for open for vendors on Saturday. So if you see me over at the registration table afterwards, we have a cake. We have a cake that we want to cut because in remembrance of the farewell. To celebrate, I would say so. They say to commemorate, but I'm going to say celebrate, okay? The Fair Housing Act. But, finally, I just want to quote what Rashad has on his letter. He says, Maya Angelou says, if you don't know where you've come from, what? You don't know where you're going. Okay, and that was the purpose of this program today. Thank you all so much.
Wow. Hope everyone's been got something out of it. And if you have any questions, you got the number of people to call. We got one other thing to do, and I'm not talented enough to do this. We're gonna sing, lift your voice and sing. But before we do it, before we go, our director is going to come forward. But I want to thank everyone for being here. It's been my downright amazing pleasure to stand for so good friends and to be a vessel in this community. community health, the Dallas Association of Realtors are here to help you. Thank you so much.
Let us all stand for the Black National Anthem.
Lift every